second session, which we're calling active agents in our addiction. And the part of the thinking behind this session is that sometimes I think we forget that we are, after all, biological beings, and our present is very much informed about our past, our evolutionary development. And unless we have a full understanding of that evolutionary development, we cannot fully understand the relationship between how we behave in the environment in which we live. So we're going to have two presentations to begin with that explore that perspective from drugs and from alcohol. And then we'll have a slightly different presentation, but still within a similar sort of theme, thinking about sugar and pushing the boundaries in addiction. So our first presenter is Roger Sullivan, who's a professor of biological anthropology at California State University in Sacramento. His passion, I think, is to use evolutionary theory to further understanding of mental and behavioral disorders. And Roger, you're going to talk about an evolutionary and ecological perspective of human drug use. Thank you for coming all of this way to do it. We look forward to your talk.
Hello. I was saying now it's the afternoon, we probably need some of that non-alcoholic whiskey to get things moving. Yeah? Okay, so I'm an anthropologist, so clearly a change in topic. I'm going to talk about evolutionary processes that definitely affect animal behavior around drugs, and where I'm going with it is whether we can extend animal models to humans as well. So in nature, we have two powerful evolutionary processes that affect animal interactions with drugs, and here by drugs I mean psychoactive plant toxins. It's probably more useful to visualize these processes rather than the abstract selection pressures as problems faced by animals. And I'm going to talk about two problems. The first is avoiding toxic punishment from plant diets. If you're an animal, and the second is avoiding infection from parasites. And in nature, many animals actively manage their dietary plant toxins and counter-exploit them to treat their parasites. So a key question is whether or not this was true for our ancestors, and if it's true for people today, and I'm going to argue that it is. Okay, so let's look at the dynamic. This first problem, toxic punishment from plant diets, that we can call the punishment model. So this is true for any animal, whether it's it's an invertebrate or an insect, or in this case, a small mammal. Most animals, of course, are herbivores. They're dependent on plants. And their number one problem in their day, is getting enough food to eat, So if you're a herbivore, of course, what you want to eat is a plant. Now, shifting focus here for a moment from the herbivore to the plant, does the plant want to be eaten? Of course it doesn't, It's invested all its energy in producing starches, and it doesn't want them to be eaten by anything else. So no, it doesn't want to be eaten. So the animal has a problem, though, in that it animals want to eat it. So what does it do? It redirects a lot of its energy to metabolizing secondary compounds, which are toxins. Many of those toxins, because they're subject to selection from plants, have evolved to mimic animal neurotransmitters and to bind in the nervous systems of animals to interfere with their behavior or to make them sick. So the solution for the plant, or the main solution for the plant, is a toxin defense. So this produces, in turn, a problem for the herbivore. In order to get its food, it has to get around the plant toxic defences, and the solution for the herbivore is to evolve mechanisms that allow it to do that. Okay, so what we see in the end is that you don't really have a separate herbivore-plant, herbivore niche and a plant niche. what you have is one niche and both entities are in it, and they're in an antagonistic relationship. This is, of course, excluding the example of fruit. So you have an antagonistic relationship, and we call this a co-evolutionary dynamic, where each entity affects the other one. Okay, so plant toxin defences have led to the evolution of toxin-defeating mechanisms in mammals. What am I talking about? Well, here's some of the most obvious ones, and we can talk about sensory mechanisms like taste and smell receptors for detecting chemicals, the vomiting nausea adaptation we've already heard about today, behavioural adaptations like neophobia or avoiding new substances, and geophagy, which is eating soil to bind poisons. Probably the main one is the one at the top there, the biochemical pathways in animals that metabolise toxins before they poison the animal. And, of course, the main adaptation for doing this is the cytochrome P450 family of genes and enzymes. Okay, so these dynamics are well documented in nature in general, yeah? The question is, do they apply to people too? This graphic here, it shows the family tree for human evolution. It's 6 to 7 million years long. It includes all our various relative species that came and went over the last 6 to 7 million years. That is since the divergence with ape ancestors. And I'm not sure you can see that little red line there. That little red line that popped up, that's the 20,000 year mark. This is when our ancestors started experimenting with horticulture. And that little blue line there is the 10,000 years ago, so roughly when the agricultural revolution occurred and our ancestors started eating domesticated plants. So the point I'm making here is that if you subtract 10,000 years from 6.5 million years, that's how long our ancestors have been subsisting on wild plants, because of course there was no domesticated plants before the agricultural revolution. Okay, so how toxic? We can look at the wild cousins of our domesticated varieties to get some clues about the sorts of toxins we're talking about. This figure shows five potato species. The one on the left is the domesticated potato. The other four on the right are wild potato species. And the green bars show the primary metabolites, the starch in the potato. And the blue shows the dry weight amount of the glycoalkaloid poison in these species. So what you can see, two things, right? That there's very little in the domesticated plant, and there's really a lot in the wild varieties. And so the implication here is that our ancestors were exposed to really large amounts of dietary plant toxins. Okay, a case has been made that humans are separate from nature, A, because of domestication, and secondly, because of culture. And so a good deal of the research of myself and my colleagues is focused on various data sets that can say whether that's true or not, and focusing on, again, on P450 gene and enzyme variation in humans, we see a lot of evidence for selection of xenobiotic P450 genes, that is, genes that are specifically for environmental chemicals. We see that enzyme binding efficiency is very high. These two points, it's a bit obscure, I guess, but from an evolutionary perspective, we know that natural selection removes things that aren't used. Yeah. So these data show that these mammalian adaptations in people are under selection, that is, that they're still operating. We see population variation in gene variability, which suggests that different populations have been subject to different selection pressures. We benefit a lot from genomic data, which shows that the hot spots in the human genome for selection are immunity, followed by chemical sensors, followed by P450 variation. And then, of course, we have the non-genetic data of all the drugs that people use. Okay, so in to answer the question of whether or not humans have been separated from nature, are they different from other animals in these dynamics? I have to say no. That plant toxin defences have led to evolution of these mechanisms in mammals and also in people. Okay, so of course it's interesting that all of the most commonly used human drugs are plant secondary metabolites. Yeah? So going down the left-hand column there, you see all our favourites that cover most human substance use. And even when we have, you know, so-called synthetic varieties like amphetamines, of course, they're modelled on a natural alkaloids, in this case, the cathinone alkaloid from the plant cart. Okay, so if we look along the top now and use tobacco as an example, the toxin, of course, is nicotine. Nicotine mimics the acetylcholine receptor, and it binds at nicotinic receptors in animals, not just people. Okay, so summary of this first problem that animals have about avoiding toxic punishment from plants. Plant-animal antagonism causes co-evolution within the shared ecological niche, no question. The second question, have humans been separated from this process? And I'd say no. Okay, so this takes us to our second problem that we see in nature, that animals that are busy solving the first problem often have an opportunity to deal with the second major problem in the list of problems for animals, and that is being parasitized. So in nature, all animals have their parasites, whether they be bacteria or large parasites, as in this case, a tobacco hornworm that's infected with parasitic wasp larvae. Okay, so where I'm going here is that pharmacophagy is a common strategy in nature where animals take the toxins in the animal in the plants that they eat and counter-exploit them for another purpose, which is treating their parasites. So the picture on the left is a picture of a chimp eating Vinonia genus toxic plants to kill their intestinal parasites. On the right is a reference to the great research by Villalba and Provenza at Utah University showing that livestock eat alfalfa to use the tannins to regulate their helminth loads. And in the middle, we have an example of a common strategy in nature, which is aposematism, which is to eat plant toxins and then sequester them to make you poisonous to your predators. Here's a little experimental example of the costs and benefits of pharmacophagy. These are parasitized tobacco hornworms again. They live on tobacco, obviously. On the left, you have two columns there. These are parasitized worms. And the black column shows the weight of the animals that are on a nicotine diet. And the column on the left shows the weight of the animals that are not on a nicotine diet. Yeah? And it shows that the ones who are eating nicotine, it's toxic to the wasps and they're less parasitized, yeah? Interestingly, on the right, it shows that this only works when the worms are parasitized. If they're not parasitized, you see there's the poison is toxic to the tobacco hornworm too, and they're smaller than the ones that aren't eating nicotine. Okay, so is this true for humans? If humans had a helminth problem, well, yes, they have. By helminths, I mean intestinal worms. In the past, our ancestors had endemic worm infestations. And today, in the non-industrialized world, there are still a lot of people with worm infections. And the WHO calculate that the global burden of disease for worm infection is between TB and malaria. Okay, so this leads to our second hypothesis around this problem. Are humans like other animals in this regard too? Have they practiced pharmacophagy and do they do it today? And if that's so, is recreational drug use a form of self-medication against parasites? And our research focus has been nicotine because there's lots of data and because we know that nicotine actually does kill parasites. Okay, so a study that myself and my colleagues did recently was conducted amongst the Aka people of the Central African Republic. This is a group of hunter-gatherers. The rationale for doing this is because they're hunter-gatherers, so in many ways their life ways are more like our ancestors than ours are. They have high levels of intestinal parasites. That is, more than 90% of people have infections. They males have a prevalence rate of 90% smoking, and they have almost no access to commercial antihelmintics. Our variables were salivary cotinine, which is a metabolite of nicotine, which lasts longer than nicotine does, and a count of worm burden with three species, hookworm, large round worms, and small round worms, which are all endemic in this area. And the initial study was three saliva and three stool samples per subject over 6 days, and we also considered some control variables. So we actually did four studies. I'm only going to talk about two because I have no time. The first is just a straight observational study. What we find is there's a direct relationship between worm burden and tobacco consumption as measured by cotinine. And incidentally, recently found a similar effect for THC in cannabis. The more complex study was a trial where afterwards the sample was randomised into albendazole treatment, which is a worm treatment, or placebo. And the prediction was that elimination of worms should decrease smoking. And this was done 2 weeks after the initial study. And this is what we found, was that the treatment group, there was a significant decrease in smoking once they had no parasites. The other group, of course, still continued to smoke, and that the largest decrease was amongst the men who had the most helmets. Okay, so in conclusion, in nature, animal behaviour in relation to plant toxins is predicted by the punishment model. And animal herbivores actively counter-exploit the toxins in their niche. They're not passive towards them, and use them as defences against their own predators and parasites. Humans were not separate from nature, so these processes happened in the past and maybe in the present. Therefore, contemporary human behaviour may be affected by these conserved mammalian mechanisms and may predict human interactions with recreational drugs. Our initial studies generally supported these ideas. And a final note, even though it's another topic, in the evolutionary ecological perspective, reward is never invoked. Yeah, the toxins are always toxic. They're toxic to the plants, they're toxic to the animals that eat them food, and they're toxic for the when they're used as a counter-exploitation as well. And acknowledgements to funders and my colleagues and graduate students and field research assistants and study participants. Thank you.
Brilliant. Thank you, Roger, very much for a really kind of fascinating insight. A wealth of material, very nicely presented in a very succinct time. Thank you. Okay, questions, comments, discussions. Robin.
Doesn't this bring addiction back? You're arguing that there's something built into our natures that is adaptive or to repeated use of something?
Maybe. I think that from the... And I must point out that usually I'm talking to other evolutionary theorists, not people who actually do useful things with information. So so I'm not used to thinking necessarily about some of these things, but really our focus is on motivation. And addiction is something that happens further down the track. And So I mean, the initial problem from the evolutionary perspective is what causes initial substance seeking, and less so, you know, what the causes of chronic use are.
It's not the initial substance seeking. You go to Canada, you didn't buy your first time you ate it.
Can we get the microphone over here?
It's not about the, as I understood what you were saying, it's not about the initial use, it's around, you know, learning from that, right?
Well, this comes down to the whole debate about what the nature of the brain is, yeah? And usually, from our perspective, it's not necessarily implying learning. I mean, this is more of a, probably a Kantian perspective, where you're assuming that selection has led to the evolution of certain cognitive processes that function to influence behaviour rather than a learning process. Although you could explain it as a learning process, but then you wouldn't necessarily need an evolutionary argument, if that makes sense.
Okay, Ryan out? Wait for the microphone, thanks.
It's a direct follow-up. Like, the poisons usually taste bad, so you would expect the individual to shy away. Now, we learn to eat bad things because our mothers tell us to do so, etc. But it's kind of hard to see the mechanism, but I think it comes down to basically the same big question mark.
Well, again, I think it's a really different way of thinking about it. I mean, the way, what it suggests about all these mechanisms is they're not for... they're useful for a range of things. They can tell you when something's too toxic, and they might be useful for titrating dosage. I mean, Michael Huffman has a really good story in this regard about self-medication in chimpanzees, where he points out that when chimpanzees get very severe helminth infections, they'll start with a relatively low dosage of toxic plants. And if it doesn't work, they'll work their way right up to a lethal dosage, or just sub-lethal dosage. And they will, it's literally their last gasp try, and they will actually kill themselves with the toxins in the plants.
Thank you. Patricia?
So I'd just like to go back to something you said about the added value of an evolutionary theory over and above the cognitive theory. So you could explain this process through operant conditioning and negative reinforcement processes. You know, what does the evolutionary theory offer over and above that process?
Well, what we're saying is that's unlikely, right? What we're saying is the model is not people, it's what animals in nature do, yeah? So when we're explaining the behaviour of an animal in its ecological niche, we don't have to propose, for example, that a tobacco hornworm has to learn how to titrate nicotine to protect it from its parasites. Again, it's a Kantian perspective. It's assuming that this is an evolved adaptation. And so all we're saying is that, myself and my colleagues, is that all we're saying is there is no division between people and nature, yeah? So what we see in nature is plausible that is true for people as well.
I just wanted to follow up on my comment, though. To me, it would be even more convincing if you could demonstrate that in a disease state, exploratory behavior does increase. And I'm not sure if those kind of data actually exist. I mean, there's something called pica, where, you know, people start to, you know, ingest substances and so on when they're highly stressed, but it's very rare. And you actually don't see high levels of exploratory behavior in animals or in humans when they are stressed.
You see it in animals when they have toxic loads. So leaf-eating primates, when they have a gut full of leaves, they'll go and eat dirt or ash, and they do it commonly. It's not rare. But the whole pica thing is that, I mean, yeah, it's interesting. I mean, of course, one of the interesting things is that it's most common amongst pregnant women in the early stages of pregnancy. So you don't have to be experts to see where I'm going there, right? That it could be a defensive mechanism.
Okay. We're going to go on to Ian. Did you want to say something?
Thank you. Were you surprised how quickly deworming changed behaviour? And how do you explain the difference between men and women in their smoking?
Good question. So, surprised. Well, as far as we know, no similar studies have been done, so we didn't really know what to expect.
Were there any comparable animal studies that suggested this might be the case?
Not that I'm aware of, actually. In terms of the... of course, there are very patterned sex differences in substance use in general. Again, myself and my colleagues speculate that in the case of nicotine's an incredibly toxic compound, and again, it's really bad if you're pregnant. So we speculate that that in this case, that there could be that women don't use it as much.
It's a highly addictive substance, yet the men very quickly cut their smoking down. Interesting.
Well, again, that's privileging addiction. We're kind of suggesting, I guess we're heading another direction, which is ambitious, I know.
Yeah, thank you. Jan, can we get the microphone? Thank you. We'll make this the last question and then move on, and we'll have plenty of time, I hope, still at the end to come back. You have a question? Okay.
Okay. Yeah. I have a short question too. I was just wondering, or curious actually, whether animals would be eating plants not just for food or to treat parasites, but just simply to seek pleasure, right? For the fun in nature. So we know in controlled experiments with animals, you know, animals get addicted as well, and they like the drugs, they like it. But is this something that you observe in the wild as well?
Well, it's problematic, but yes, there's lots of excellent anecdotal data of animal drug use and animals getting out of it in nature. But of course, if you try and utilise that as evidence, it gets criticised as being anecdotal. So yes, there is, but it's difficult data to use. Yeah. In fact, it reminds me, I have this great video of a chimpanzee who lives in the zoo who started stealing cigarettes from the zookeepers and hiding them around his place and smoking them on the quiet. But I digress.
Okay, thank you. Last question from Franklin.
I'm just curious, where did the folks get their cigarettes from? Are they rowing their own, or did Philip Morris it there before we got there?
So you're talking about the Aka?
Yeah.
Yes. So, of course, there was no tobacco in Africa until probably about 1500. But another area of my colleague's work there is looking at the local plants. And there's a local plant called Motunga, which has a lot of alkaloids in it. And we're in the process of studying that plant to see exactly what alkaloids. And this was the plant that was used, or we suspect was the traditional plant that was used for long periods. And that's right, that cannabis and nicotine has to be a recent, 500-year recent arrival. But again, we're implying that in animals, they have mechanisms that make them seek out specific drugs. Yeah, they're going to tend to seek out chemicals in general, or maybe a class of chemicals like cholinergic compounds. I don't know, but that's another question to answer.
And this question was also specifically now: where do the men buy their cigarettes
Very
cigarettes?
Good question. So the Aka. They live in the forest, but they live in proximity with farming communities. And they, for parts of the year, they exchange their labour with the farming communities, and the main way they're paid is with cigarettes and cannabis.
Okay, thank you. That's another perspective. Yeah. Roger, thank you very much indeed. Okay, we're now going to move on to what some people have called our favourite drug, which is alcohol. And Robert Dudley, who's a professor of integrative biology from the University of California, is going to talk about alcohol. Amongst many things, Robert is famous, I should say, for one of his books, The Drunken Monkey, which, if you have not read, I thoroughly recommend to read. I really did enjoy it. Robert is also going to talk about an evolutionary perspective and approach to alcohol. Thank you.
Great. Well, thanks for the chance to speak here today.
I'm going to try to convince you there's a link between ancient primate behaviors and modern-day human drinking behaviors. I'm not a clinician, so I apologize. Now I realize it for the perhaps antiquated use of the word alcoholism and addiction, so semantic impropriety on my part, I apologize. So Darwin got there first in an odd sense. Most monkeys would be habitually attracted to alcohol if they could get it. They couldn't buy it from the locals. So, you know, he had this sense of primates. This goes back to an ancient anecdotal literature about primates being attracted to alcohol. But nobody had ever made the link with ancestral diet. Where does the alcohol come from anyway? So I started working on this about 20 years ago. And, of course, Pasteur got there in the mid-19th century. It's fermentative, anaerobic fermentation of carbohydrates, simple sugars, yields alcohol. So it's a biotic process. The yeast are basically killing off bacteria via fermentation. And you know that because you can homebrew up to 8 or 10%. You can't go higher than that. It becomes auto-inhibitory. But bacteria have much lower lethal thresholds for alcohol. So basically, the alcohol is killing off microbial competitors, it's thought, within the body of a ripe and fermenting fruit. And we can date this to the mid-Cretaceous, this both the fermentative pathways in yeast and the origins of sugar-rich, fleshy fruits. So it's a really, within 10 million years, it's pretty good. Basically, both things evolved concurrently. So it's an ancient association. And then I just asked the question, how much alcohol is out there in the forest anyway? And agriculture gives us some answers, but that's irrelevant relative to the 20-million-year, 40-million-year history of primates. So let's go to the tropical rainforest. This is where we've worked the last 25 years on other projects, but there's a huge diversity, you know, maybe 30,000, 40,000 species of flowering plants, all kinds of crazy fruits and dispersal syndromes. Animals eat the fruit for nutritional reward, mostly sugars, in some cases lipids, and a little bit of protein. They disperse the seeds. So it's an evolved mutualism going back, again, at least 120 million years, well before the origin of mammals, by the way, where primates are newcomers to this stage, to this world. So we wanted to look, and apologize for the lighting here, but basically this is a large, this is a meter, 1.2 meter long infructescence of fruit. It weighs about 80 kilo. So usually the forests are green. If I put you in the middle of the Amazon, let you free range, you'll die within a week or two. You run out of food. It's really hard to find food in tropical forests. So actually ethanol may be a cue. It's a very low molecular weight, volatile molecule that sort of wafts through the forest. If animals can smell it and fly or move upwind to the source of ethanol, this they will find 80 kilograms of fruit. And then they binge consume. So I can't show the video here because the codec, the translator, didn't seem to survive the trip across the Atlantic. But I can tell you this is a spider monkey, and it's found the fruit. This is in central Panama. And I usually do this in faculty meetings, behave like a monkey. But, you know, it's sort of at the infructescence, and it's just grabbing and gobbling this fruit. It's binge feeding. It's feeding as much as it can get. So it's a common widespread behavior for primates, which are ancestrally found within the tropics and which ancestrally feed on fruit. So let's characterize ripening. We measure sugar. We can measure alcohol using a variety of methods in the field. Fruits start out hard. They soften, become palatable for consumption. Color, they start out green. Then they advertise suitability for consumption. So they turn red or orange or purple, a huge range of interesting ripening syndromes. And so all these things are changing concurrently, and we can measure all of them. Of course, yeast and bacterial population densities are changing. But again, the animals have to find the fruit, and then they consume the fruit. Where there is sugar, following Pasteur, there is alcohol. So let's look at some data. This is really not coming out well, but percent sugar on the x-axis, ethanol content on the y-axis. Green fruits have no measurable alcohol, and that's completely what we'd expect. But my a priori categorizations of ripe, orange, and overripe red fruits yield alcohol levels as high as 8%, an average of 0.5%. So light or weak beer, but you know, you think 0.5%, that's nothing. These animals eat 5 to 10% of their body weight a day in ripe fruit. Most of them only eat ripe fruit. So even though the concentration is low, the overall dosage is high because they're pushing so much volume through their gut. They never get inebriated because their gut fills prior to reaching high levels of sort of psychoactive levels of alcohol in the bloodstream. But they are getting a lot of alcohol, and presumably they're taking advantage of it. So let's just hypothesize. You can use alcohol plumes to find fruit in the forest. You should prefer to eat alcohol-containing fruits. Alcohol can only be present when there are sugars present. So they're a reliable marker of the presence of sugars. And that's these animals, Most of these fruit-eating mammals and birds will eat fruit 90% of their diet. Okay, so they have to find these fruits and consume them rapidly. They are potentially getting high alcohol loads. So, and then let's just hypothesize that alcohol consumption via fruit eating is positively associated with caloric gain. The aperitif effect, so it stimulates feeding, the animals basically eat more, and their gut fills, and then they stop. So this is a kind of a set of hypotheses. Now, what do we know actually about what's out there? There's a lot of animal drunkenness. I collect these stories, and they're really interesting, but there's no real data, okay? So there's a lot of stories of drunken birds, mammals, fruit-eating butterflies that are feeding on sap of fermenting fruit and so on. It's all badly anecdotal. A couple cases of alcohol poisoning and cedar waxwings in North America. Again, animals never get enough load in the forest. They can't get the high concentrations, and then they can't get the volumes. So they're getting a chronic low-level exposure. So chimps on breathalyzers is the research agenda here. It would be hard to do, but we need to know what the average blood alcohol content is of a fruit-eating primate. There are absolutely zero data on this point. It's a great shame from the literature. We do know a lot about flies, so they follow ethanol to find oviposition sites. So flies can do it. Fruit-eating birds and mammals ought to be able to do it. There's genetic variation in the ability to metabolize ethanol. That screams evolutionary possibility. Lifespan and fecundity of fruit flies increase at intermediate levels of exposure. This is called hormesis by the toxicologists. So basically, these are experiments done for completely other different reasons, but let me just show you the data. Percent ethanol, this is vapor ethanol and exposure of adult flies, and relative mortality. So you can actually increase the lifespan by a huge 20% by exposing flies to low concentration alcohol relative to either what we could call abstention or higher levels of exposure. So perhaps this is just the antimicrobial activity of alcohol killing off incipient infections within the bodies of the flies or of the medium that their larvae are consuming. We don't know the mechanism, in other words, but it's a real effect. So here's a chimp in the rainforest in Uganda. Can we get that video if possible, please? And these are fig fruits, believe it or not. It's going to find one to eat. We don't know why it picked this tree or this branch. It's going to look at it, and then it's a happy chimp eating a ripe fig. Now, there's probably ethanol in this fig. It's a totally wild system. So let's just look at this once more, and we can look at a couple things. So there are a lot of figs that the animal could potentially eat. Can we see that once more, if possible? And it's going to palpate the fruits and not eat them. And it's also looking, so it's using vision. It's going to pick one, and it's going to smell right there, and then it eats. If you watch your fellow humans in the supermarket, you will see exactly the same behaviors. I'm not making this up. It's uncannily similar to modern-day people. So what we know is that fruit selection, again, 90% of the diet for chimps is ripe fruit. They have to find these fruits and consume them on a chronic basis. Vision, palpation, and olfaction. Olfaction can work at long distance, as it does with fruit flies, but it also theoretically could work at short distance. So, and this is an intentionally misleading figure, but let's look at percent frugivory. How much fruit is in the diet? Less than 5% or greater than 50%. Going back 20 million years, gibbons, orangutans, gorillas, chimps, and ourselves, with the exception of the Highland gorillas, which don't eat fruit because there is no fruit above 2,000 meters. The plants are too energetically challenged to produce big, fat, sugar-rich fruit. Basically, all of our closest ancestors are eating fruit. Actually, these numbers for chimps would be like 90, 95% of the time. So the argument is here, our closest ancestors, actually going back 20 million years, have had chronic dietary exposure to ethanol. And it's been actually that the psychoactive effects may derive precisely because they stimulate feeding and let the animal find more effectively fruit in the rainforest. So human alcoholism, what do we know? I'm really way out of my league here, but I'll do my best. Heritability, based on narrow sense heritability, based on split twin studies, part of those genetic basis. If it weren't genetic, we wouldn't think evolution necessarily. There's genetic variation in the enzymes that metabolize alcohol in modern day humans, and they're vaguely correlated with propensity toward abuse. So I'm talking about the East Asian polymorphisms in ADH and ALDH. And if you look, you don't want to do the Europe, whatever you mean by Western Europe or North American versus East Asia, because Asia is a cultural construct. It doesn't actually have a biological or, sort of founded geographical definition. But if you look within East Asia, so people have slow-acting ADH and ALDHs. It renders them sick when they drink. My wife, who's Han Chinese, will just look at a molecule of ethanol and collapse. I mean, it's amazing how strong this effect is. It's a deterrent to drinking. You can't become an alcoholic if you're not drinking alcohol, right? By definition. So, but even within East Asia, people, there are alcoholics. People classify as such using local definitions. They are 10 times more likely to have the fast-acting versions of these enzymes. So it's the only genetic, sort of known genetic correlate of alcoholic behavior, however you define it. It's defined differently in different ways by different people, of course. There's also nice epidemiology going back to the 1970s. Chronic low-level ethanol consumption reduces cardiovascular disease, and in Western industrialized societies, overall mortality. And these studies are mostly confined to non-Asian populations, so that would be a very interesting further test of the hypothesis. Distillation, the high concentrations of alcohol and the high volumetric availability are only very recent in human history, like the last 1,000 years, I think, in Central Asia and Western Europe. So now, today, we have high volume, high concentration, whereas in the rainforest, we had, you know, very widespread, dispersed, low concentration alcohol, but chronic exposure. So in other words, there's an evolutionary mismatch between what primates experiences they were evolving over the last 20 million years and what we experience today. Just as with sugar and fats and diabetes and obesity incidence, this is going through the roof in modern day society, so too this is just it's an evolutionary outcome. And I call it a hangover. This is an evolutionary hangover. We can't get away from it. So what can we say about human alcoholism? We associate ethanol with nutritional gain, promoting rapid localization and consumption of ethanol-containing resources, even binge consumption in certain cases. That's an evolutionary consequence. And then this is coming from a field called evolutionary medicine, Darwinian medicine in some cases. Disadvantageous behaviors in an ancestral environment become disadvantageous when you have unlimited ad libitum access to nutritional substrates. So it's a broad category of substances, not just alcohol, obviously sugar, animal fat, a whole bunch of other kinds of things. So that's an evolutionary context for excessive, well, both normal and excessive. The point is there's a continuous spectrum of behavioral response to alcohol deriving from our primate ancestry. There's no fine line between who is and is not an alcoholic because it's a much broader spectrum of behaviors. And I know this is modern-day human mortality. Sorry for the black color there. And the daily number of standard drinks. And you all know what standard means here, not me. But and I gather this is a meta-analysis. And there have been many meta-analyses out there in the literature. But as with the fruit flies, there appear to be health-related benefits to low-level alcohol consumption. And this was what we would predict by hormesis and evolutionary interpretations of chronic exposure. So just to wrap it up. In East Asia, there's wonderful work on both the ADH and ALDH showing these very sharp climbs. Something different happened coincident with the origins of rice cultivation. So here's the high frequency of a fast-acting ADH, and these points here are historical centers of rice cultivation. So in the last 10,000 years, there has been human evolution, both in various features of diet, but also in features of ethanol metabolism. And people have gone out now, since I first published what I call the drunken monkey hypothesis, 15 years ago, others have found not drunken tree shrews. They get high amounts of alcohol from fermenting nectar. Floral nectar is fermenting. They exhibit ethyl glucuronide in their hair, as do human alcoholics, otherwise not found in the animal kingdom. So chronic intake of fermented floral nectar. And this was a great paper about a year and a half ago. Hominids adapted to metabolize ethanol long before human-directed fermentation. So they reconstructed expressing ancestral enzymes for ADH going back 20 million years, expressed them in E. coli and measured their ethanol metabolizing properties. They showed that about 20 million years ago, the enzyme increased in catalytic efficiency by about a factor of 12. So basically indicating a genomic signature of natural selection passed in the capacity to degrade ethanol. And that links with interesting patterns in evolution of the great ape. So there is a deep-rooted evolutionary exposure. So how do animals find ripe fruit over the distances in tropical rainforests? To end with questions. What is the typical alcohol level in fruit, and how often do animals become inebriated, if ever? It's rare, but that's because they probably have good enzymes, and they're just not getting enough load to get actually drunk. Does alcohol act as a feeding stimulant in the real world? We know what happens with humans, but what about other animals? What are the long-term benefits of alcohol for all animals, not just humans and fruit flies? So this is the research agenda. And to conclude with Velázquez, los borrachos, the drunkards, the immortal giving the gift of wine to the mere humans. So it's an amazing molecule. It can inspire us and it can destroy us. And I think we all are cognizant of this continuous spectrum of responses. But I think to really understand the nature and the quantitative expression of that spectrum, we have to adopt an evolutionary perspective. Thank you.
Thank you, Robert, also for a fantastic summary of complex and complicated evidence. Very beautifully done. Okay, questions, comments? Jürgen.
I have a question about the J-shaped curves you were showing. The human and the current epidemiology attributes the J-shaped curve mainly to ischemic heart diseases, right, which did not play a role in mortality for several hundred years, which are fairly new that the chronic diseases now play this very important role. There's no other beneficial effects which would explain this J-shaped curve. So I wonder how a J-shaped curve can exist, cease through several centuries, and then re-exist again, and that's called evolutionary.
So we know there's also a J-shaped curve in the fruit flies, and I showed you those data. And guess what? They have no cardiovascular system per se. So it may be just the antimicrobial activity of ethanol. I mean, microbes are everywhere. They're in our mouths, right? One of the interesting ideas about cardiovascular risk is that these arteriosclerotic plaques that are forming in coronary arteries may actually be initiated microbially. And subsequently, I'm no doctor, so please don't quote me on this, but you know that's basically the origin of some of these arteriosclerotic plaques. So I think you know microbes are certainly pervasive, and there are many different kinds of infections. So I agree with you. What we see today is the modern-day epidemiology. What about the non-human systems that are naturally exposed to ethanol? Can we do the experimental intervention to actually check to see if there is lifespan prolongation as a consequence of low-dosage ethanol? That's been done for fruit flies. There is one study for lab mice, which shows an identical U-shaped curve. Mechanism unknown. But I agree with you. This is a plea for more data, right?
Thank you. Maria? Wait for the microphone, please.
I just heard that also the cardiovascular diseases, heart attacks and so on, also now people think, or doctors more think, that it's infections. It's actually also related to that. So when you answer that question, I wonder, could that also be a link?
So part of it is a linkage with just infections generally. And I'm not a clinician. But the other way to think about it would be to ask what's going on in East Asia. So does that U-shaped dosage response curve pertain to East Asians in terms of lifespan? And that study's actually never been done, or if it's been done, I've never been able to find it. So these are non-East Asian populations. But if you have populations that basically, for genetically based reasons, are not consuming alcohol at all, or at very low levels relative to Western European populations, then you should expect a differential response to alcohol in terms of lifespan. And so that's another way to think about it in a broader time scale. And those data seem not to have been gathered. Yeah.
Okay, just before we go on to the next question, are we getting any questions in from our external audience? Okay, let's hope we get some. Ian?
Just a comment on that point, that there has been a Mendelian randomization study separating a population according to ADH polymorphism, and assuming there's no link between ADH metabolism and heart disease per se, you'd expect the instance of heart disease to be greater in those that were the fast metabolizers,
correct.
And in fact the outcome was the reverse, which argues against there being a genuine effect of alcohol, beneficial effect of alcohol on the cardiovascular system, because as you know, the discussions have been bedeviled by confounding factors. The people who drink one glass of wine every other day are also the ones who jog and eat a Mediterranean diet, etc., etc. So the Mendelian randomization actually does not support the idea that alcohol is protective against cardiovascular disease.
So I accept that for ADH, but there are two loci involved, right? There's ALDH as well, and it's the interaction effect. And the intermediate product is acetaldehyde, which may actually also be involved in sort of amelioration of some of these microbial infections. So I think, you know, it's fascinating. And I'm not obviously I'm not a practitioner in this field, but to see multiple meta-analysis upon meta-analysis yielding different results. So I think it's still, you know, first described by Klasky in 1970, this beneficial effect of alcohol consumption. It's just amazing that we can't resolve that. Why can't we resolve that? I don't know. Well, I think it goes back to 19th century, actually, with the rigidity of coronary arteries. But yeah, it's an ancient observation.
Okay, any more questions? No, we'll have time at the end of the session to come back. So Robert, thank you very much. You mentioned sugar a lot in your presentation, and the next presentation is sugar. It's from Laura Schmidt, also from California. In fact, this session is a California session, I think. And you have been studying and pushing boundaries of addiction. You've also been considering what are the public health lessons that we can learn from alcohol as they apply to sugar. And you're going to talk to us about sugar, pushing boundaries in addiction. Thank you, Laura.
Thank you, Peter. Actually, I'm not so sure to thank you. I was wondering why am I, as a sociologist of the globalizing world and postmodernity, on a panel with a bunch of evolutionary biologists, and I figured it was because we're all from California. But I think it is just like the idea of scrapping the whole addiction concept and shifting over to a notion of heavy use over time. What we're really interested in here in this panel is in pushing the boundaries around addiction concepts and whether you view loss of control and craving and these other aspects of the addiction concept as epiphenomena related to chronic heavy use over time, or you view them as part of a syndrome, psychological illness. I think one of the really interesting things that I've learned about sugar is how are the globalizing economy is shifting the boundaries in and making us really rethink the way that we understand sugar and many other behaviors and substances. So I want to start by just talking about the context, and we can have an interesting conversation later about this evolutionary debate around why is it that fructose, the sugar that makes fruit sweet, why is it almost exclusively metabolized in the liver, which is also where ethanol is metabolized through the very same process. Today, because of excess sugar consumption, we have an epidemic of non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. A third of Americans are walking around with non-alcoholic fatty liver disease due to excess fructose consumption, as well as other junk foods. But so here we are, these creatures that are not very well adapted to a globalized world in which large corporations are producing massive quantities of engineered foods. We call them hyperpalatable foods, carefully engineered by food scientists to make them make us want, crave and want more. They're designed to maximize human pleasure, maximize the demand for the product, therefore secure market share. The very technologies that we use to find cures for addiction are being used in laboratories and corporations around the world to figure out how to make the Doritos chips recipe a little more palatable, a little more exciting to our palate, and to make us want more. And so how do we understand food, industrialized food, in the context of addiction? And when I really started looking into this issue, I realized that that there's a growing trend. I live near Silicon Valley and interact with a lot of the people down there, and it's not just food anymore. It's practically every product out there, and particularly technologies. This is a book, a very, very popular book in Silicon Valley, and if you read it, essentially the author, who's basically a management guru, uses all of the behavioral science and neuroscience that we have grown up on to help companies figure out ways to make the cell phone, the video game a little more habit forming. And so in an environment in which these products are being carefully engineered specifically to get us at least to form habits and crave them, how do we understand the meaning of addiction? So inevitably, somebody winds up going to someone in the addiction field and says, what's going on here? Nora Volkow, the director of NIDA, who's an fMRI expert, goes on to says addiction and compulsive eating are essentially the same. They're a distorted valuation of the reward system derived from a certain behavior, i.e. drug-taking or eating. The two conditions have roots in some of the same brain areas and circuits, including the hypothalamus, prefrontal cortex, and limbic system. So this got me thinking about, are we really being forced here to shift the whole way that we understand addiction in the context of a globalized economy with corporations carefully using scientific techniques that we've many of the labs at NIDA developed to develop products, food products, and all sorts of products that are designed to make us crave them and want more and keep on coming back. And I started to think about the dopamine hypothesis in light of this, because typically that's what's invoked when people talk about an addiction to sugar or an addiction to internet gaming and so forth. They talk about the reward, how all of these reward-inducing substances and behaviors have some addictive potential. And at some point along the way, you get to the point where anything is potentially that's reward-producing can be addictive if the dose is concentrated enough. So essentially, the dose is the poison. And sugar provides an interesting example of that. So currently, many people are probably familiar with the sugar wars. We had a tobacco war, and now we have a sugar war. UK's actively debating taxation. Mexico just passed soda taxes. And throughout this whole debate, there's this ongoing discussion about how sugar is addictive. And I'm constantly being asked, you know, is it addictive or isn't it? And I want to share with you some of the evidence, and I think it goes back to the pan addiction model, the idea that the literature has in some sense devolved down to the pharmacological definition of habituation or craving, that really when we're talking about addiction in this new model, we're talking about biological craving. The familiar limbic triangle, this is the current theory. My colleague Rob Lustig put this slide together to explain the relationships between stress, the hunger starvation drive, and the rewards activities that go on in the nucleus accumbens, which is essentially where all of the dopamine activity is supposed to lie. And the general argument for those who aren't familiar with it is that in the brains of humans as well as animals that have been supposedly addicted to some substance, you'll see downregulation in dopamine, and you'll also see a decline in the dopamine receptors in that part of the brain, and that therefore is a indication that there's addiction present. The evidence on sugar and drugs is rather thin. There is the human fMRI evidence that definitely shows dopamine downregulation in the brain for people who have who claim to crave sugar and have been consuming it in large doses. This is true in people with obesity as well as in rat studies. And there's a surfeit of rat evidence. I want to share some of it with you just to give you a flavor for the literature here. This is a study conducted to look at binging within rats. the blue lines being a rat that has essentially been habituated to periodic excessive sugar consumption and then had the sugar taken away, and then when it's reintroduced 21 days later, you see these spikes in sugar consumption. And the take-home message from a study like this is that the rat is binging on sugar. This is a study on evidence of sugar and the withdrawal syndrome. And here, mainly look at the left part of the slide. Here the rats have been, again, kind of habituated onto sugar, and then essentially they're put into a challenge where they're asked to swim. And the ones that have been habituated onto sugar don't swim as well, and the conclusion is that they're experiencing withdrawal. Here, the rats have been put into a maze, and the ones that have been on sugar too much don't run around as much. Cross-sensitization, again, this is the other main line of research around, in this case, it was cross-sensitizing the rats on sugar to amphetamines, but it's also been done with cocaine and so forth. So from this body of evidence and the fMRI studies showing dopamine downregulation, what we have many concluded that sugar is an addictive substance. What we don't have is much human evidence. Here are the kind of classic DSM criteria for addiction or dependence. And generally, you don't see very good studies out there. It's not quite clear how one would go about doing this. There is a Yale addiction food addiction index that basically has taken the standardized instruments from the DIS and the CD and so forth, and searched and replaced food or sugar with for alcohol and drugs. And what you so there is a modicum of general population research going on out there, but generally the evidence is a little difficult to pull together on the human side. In some cases, addiction concepts that are quite familiar to us for psychoactive substances, the traditional ones, don't make a lot of sense or make too much sense in the context of a product that is so ubiquitous in the environment. To neglect my role obligations to go get sugar isn't really, I don't have to neglect too much, right? It's everywhere. It's in 74% of the food products in your grocery store have sugar added to them. So the idea that that we would even embark on a research agenda that would try to understand food and sugar from an addiction perspective is challenging and problematic, I think, on multiple levels. I just want to, so this is sort of my effort to summarize the literature. And again, to kind of think about, well, what are the boundaries? How do we understand whether it's in animals and primates or it's in humans with these new products and food products that are engineered to make us want more? How do we even understand, from an addiction research standpoint, how to approach these issues? And so I sort of, the way I've been thinking about it is, on the one hand, you have these forms of evidence. And on the other hand, you have a myriad of addiction concepts. And I'm sorry that I didn't put heavy use over time on the list, but it ought to be there. And I think for many, many people, heavy use over time, probably the majority of Americans, are consuming sugar heavily over time. So this, I think, raises some questions about that as an addiction concept. But here you have everything from a substance that's habit-forming, that produces craving, abuse potential, all the way to physical dependence, and then you have these bodies of evidence. And at what point does the balance shift, that we have enough evidence across enough kinds of models and human experiences to meet the criteria for these various concepts that we work with in the addiction field. And maybe we need to be thinking more about this full range of experiences that are addiction related, but that don't necessarily wind up in the DSM or the ICD-10. So just to close, I want to point out that regardless of the addictive potential for sugar, any hyperpalatable food, it is a huge public health crisis that we're facing, and the previous speaker alluded to it. And some of it does have to do with the fact that fructose is almost exclusively metabolized in the liver through a process de novo lipogenesis, which is identical to how ethanol is metabolized in the liver. From an evolutionary standpoint, it's very likely our ancestors found fruit to be very rare, and our bodies learned to store it when we got it, and you jack up the global capitalist system fast enough, and you put those bodies into an environment where it's absolutely abundant everywhere, and what do you get? You get an epidemic of fatty liver disease leading to diabetes, leading to heart disease and other complications. So we are hardwired, I do believe, to want and need sugar for reasons that make no sense whatsoever in our current context. One thing that I think is absolutely critical for us as addiction and public health researchers to think about is that the markets and profit margins on these products are radically different from anything we've ever encountered. The market for sugary beverages goes from zero to death. And there's no regulation at any level, and the profit margins on these products make alcohol and tobacco look like very expensive products to produce. They're marketed selectively to low-income populations. It costs more to eat a healthier alternative. And most importantly, if our field were able or did produce evidence that these products are addictive or are even habit-forming, it would be a game changer in the policy debates that are now unfolding around this situation with our diet and particularly diabetes epidemics and so forth, because it would shift the debate off of the focus on the producers having no culpability for the harms produced by their products, and it would shift them more into the frame of a tobacco corporations and alcohol corporations, I believe. I'll end with that.
Thank you very much. You've raised a lot of interesting points. Yes, please.
George Woody from the States. There was an article in Nature fairly recently that pointed to fructose as the thing. You know, when I go outside the country, I don't see anywhere near the morbid obesity that I do walking around Philadelphia. You'll see people that can hardly walk, they're so fat. And my brother was in the sugar industry, and they switched gradually from sugar to fructose in the US because it's a lot cheaper. But if I go outside the US, like I just had a Coke for lunch, it's like the Coke that I had when I was a kid. I don't drink Cokes in the US anymore because I don't like the taste, at least a bad taste. But I just wonder if
that's actually a misnomer. I was one of the authors on that article.
You were, okay.
And so, actually what we were doing was drawing the parallels between ethanol and fructose and liver disease and making the case that why would we regulate one product that causes liver disease and feed the other to our children was basically the point. But actually sucrose, which is table sugar, is about 50% fructose, and most formulations of high fructose corn syrup about 50 to 55, so the actual fructose content isn't all that different. The corn refiners would like you to believe differently, but and there's they're at war they're uh They're like the beer and wine producers in Europe. I think they're always fighting one another. But there is a different. I think there's a different palatability to the two products. But from the standpoint, at least as far as we know, there's very little evidence showing that high fructose corn syrup is any worse than table sugar.
Okay, thank you. I think we have a question from one of our external viewers. It's your question. Okay. Sylvia, please.
Hi, I'm Sylvia. I'm working with the coordinating team of the Alice Frapp project. I've seen a recent research by a European project, a publicly funded European project. It's basic research, and what they argue is that it is a behavioral addiction. So what they say that it is not about that food items are addictive substances, but is rather the act of eating that is has an addictive nature. So I'm not sure what is your opinion about this.
I would argue that all addictive behaviors have a behavioral component to them. I mean, if you can put a heroin addict under the MRI machine and just show them a picture of the works, and you see the dopamine reward, the reward system go wild. So the argument that it's different because it's behavioral, I wouldn't accept. In the recent DSM-5 debate, they decided not to class. They talked about sugar and food a lot, but mainly sugar, and decided to classify it, that it was already in the DSM under impulse control disorders, and under compulsive overeating. And so they left it there. But of course, they opened the gate for gambling, right, which also was in that category. And so there's an interesting shift going on in the psychiatric nomenclature where it's not that it isn't already in there, it's where does it belong? And there may very well be, some of our neuroscience folks may have some interesting thoughts about what's going on in the brain in relation. I know that that impulse control disorders are, that those portions of the brain that regulate impulse are implicated in the whole the dopamine hypothesis. They're part of the pan addiction model. And so it may be that we need to rethink the relationship between impulse control disorders and addictive disorders.
Okay, I'm going to take one more question on the sugar topic, and then would like to open up to questions and comment on all of the three presentations that we've had. Lydia? Can we have a microphone for Lydia?
Well, I understood we want to get rid of the concept of dependence and addiction, and you are getting back to this, or actually you think you will gain something of bringing the topic dependence in the concept of sugar. So I would like to know why do you think it will bring much more to the idea of the problems with obesity and an idea of consumption over time, a lot of sugar. What will bring for you in an area where usually addiction is not been mentioned so much as in alcohol and drugs, what will bring to you talking about dependence and impulse control disorders and so on, instead of having use over time?
What would it mean?
You actually, the last sentence.
I think most, if you look at WHO and now new U.S. national guidelines for sugar consumption, vast majority of Americans are consuming 2.7 times too much. So the concept of heavy use over time, we all qualify, or most of us do. And so I think that's that's an interesting thing to think about. What I think probably where the most important leverage comes from applying an addiction frame to sugar and hyperpalatable foods has to do more with the policy debates. And once you, if you go back to alcohol, no ordinary commodity, and the four criteria for regulating something, one of them is that it has abuse potential and that it's addictive, that it's habit, I can't remember the exact, it's ubiquitous, and there were four criteria. Someone here who wrote that book can help. But if you can remember your four criteria. But there's one, and that's the only one that we don't have evidence that sugar qualifies for. If we did, it would be an argument to regulate it. Right now, there are these debates going on all around the world around regulating it because we just have a massive diabetes epidemic unfolding, not just in the US, but globally, everywhere, to points of extreme crisis in countries like Mexico. So it would be a big shift in the debate if we were in a position to argue that, and that's where I think the most important impact would come from redefining these food products such as sugar as addictive substances.
Okay, thank you, Laura, for that. Let's then move on and open up the discussion to all of the three different presentations that we have had in this first session this afternoon. I want to throw out a comment that if we take the lessons from evolutionary biology, that we are hardwired in the sense of seeking out drugs, in the sense of seeking out alcohol, when we think about reframing addictions governance, I want to throw up the question, what does that mean? What are the implications for that? What lessons do we take from that in terms of new policy directions, policy formation? Jürgen. Do we have the microphone for Jürgen? I've got it here.
I think basically one lesson from that would be that it makes not a lot of sense to just try to reduce or completely extinct this behavior through more and more and more punishment. I mean, that's not only from evolutionary biology, that's also from psychology, that if something is hardwired this way, you have to come up with more intelligent ways to reduce the harm which is coming out of that. And there's a number of ways, policy-wise, but one which is not working would be the current stream of punishing and of basically criminalizing the behavior.
Thank you. Tamika? It's coming from this way.
I think to what both of you said, is another point would be that you cannot regulate substances abuse because it will be a regulation for each substance when she was talking about pan addiction. So what we have to look, it's how to deal with addictions, whatever the behavior or the substance that generates it, it's creating. It's more the heavy use over time of the accumulation of different behaviors and substances that trying to regulate every one of those substances separately. Or at least having pan policies regarding addictions or heavy use over time, but not specific only. That's our tradition until now.
Okay, so common approaches is what you're saying across different substances. We're going to take Patricia and then Robin. Patricia first.
Thank you. I might be a bit provocative here, but regardless of our evolution, we've all come to learn how to use toilets. And in most societies, it's illegal to urinate or defecate in public for public health reasons. And yet, does an evolutionary argument, contribute to this? Not really. So do we have to acknowledge a hardwired or some kind of evolutionary biologic process to make good public health decisions? I think that we have to make decisions that are based on the here and now and what is helpful and harmful for people today.
Your microphone is not operating well. Does anyone like to respond to that? Yes, Alison does.
So I agree, except that what I'm hearing from the evolutionary biologists is that there might be solutions that don't involve cognition. And that's really interesting. So let's give kids worm medicine and they'll stop smoking. Forget about motivational interviewing. I mean, isn't that... So you kind of sidestep the whole cognition issue, which makes it so much easier. And I'm a clinical psychologist. So what's interesting for me about evolutionary perspectives is that they offer novel solutions that we haven't thought about, not because they explain things as they are today.
Although they do also explain things.
Yeah.
Thank you. Laura, did you want to...
Yeah. I just wanted to come back to the pan solution idea or pan policy idea. And when you really look at it, there's a vector, and it's industry. It's a large corporations, a structured system with very limited global governance, and the brakes are off. And the fact that these corporations are using the very technologies that we use to try to find cures for addiction to get people hooked ought to be illegal, in my opinion. And I do think that that the hardwired evidence matters in a policy debate. The ubiquity argument and the fact that we're hardwired to want these things, those two elements right there are important framing tools, I would think, to be talking about these issues in a common frame and not just talking about alcohol over here and tobacco over there, but to be talking about the whole... there are too many commonalities to the problems that we're looking at, all the way from sugar to heroin. Too similar.
I'm just going to take Robin in and then come back to both of you. Robin first.
Just that we need to bring in the experience with, quote, illicit, unquote, drugs also with this. In other words, that there are solutions that have been tried, you know, that also have enormous problems, you know, and so that we really are in a situation where we have these highly attractive commodities, where we're going now, America is in the U.S. is in the middle of going through a process of rediscovering for cannabis that, yes, if you do away with prohibition, you can also have a problem with the industry. We have to recognize there are the two sides of it in terms of the solutions that have been tried and so forth. There are lots of experience over the last 150 years to draw on, but that we do need to look in a pan substance way across these different all these different fields, including sugar, as we're trying to figure out the what would be a public health oriented approach that is maximally liberating for the individual and minimally but does involve controlling the market.
Thank you. Let's go to Robert and then to Roger.
Yeah, just a comment on the evolutionary approach, and I think it's early days yet for evolutionary approaches to substance abuse, but if you just look at, for example, in viral evolution and disease propagation, it's just revolutionized our interpretation of the origin and maintenance and diversification of novel diseases and viruses. So I think it's a mistake to rule it out a priori, and we have to see where it goes from here.
Thank you. Roger?
I just wanted to speak to the idea of giving kids albendazole. So what I think myself and my colleagues, the argument we're trying to make is not so much that, you know, the solution to human drug use is parasites, but looking to natural processes and seeing that wherever you see an animal-plant dynamic, yeah? So for animals of all stripes, plant toxins are ubiquitous, right? They can't escape them, yeah? And I think the point we're trying to make is that in those dynamics, the animals are never passive, right? There is always active behavior around the toxins, either in terms of not being poisoned or of taking the toxins and reusing them to solve whatever problems they have. So again, I think coming back to the human perspective, I think because of the considerable influence of reward theory and talking about policy, I think that reward often influences policy in the sense that humans are portrayed as being passive. You know, we have these inherited mechanisms, the reward pathway, and we're kind of helpless around certain types of substances, so we need to be protected from them. I think the lesson from nature is that animals are never passive around drugs.
And so in nature, our ancestors could consume as much fruit as they needed and wanted, and it might be stored in their livers and be good. But then you put us into an industrialized, commercialized environment where it's ubiquitous and concentrated dose, and it's a very different situation.
Well that's kind of a complex issue, and I'm not so sure that it's an ongoing debate. It's certainly an ongoing debate in evolutionary circles, right? There's long been this idea that current human exposure to dosage is novel, right? It's never been like this. But when you really look closely, it's at the actual data and what people actually do, it's not actually clear that that's so. Again, when you look at I gave the example of the potatoes, yeah? If you have to eat those potatoes, you have a tremendous exposure to very strong toxins, more so than what any of us would encounter today. And even if you pick a commonly used drug as an example, like for example in anthropology, we often privilege indigenous drug use, right, as being kind of somehow separate to what we do in industrialized societies. But when you look at what people actually, well, look at the ACA, look how much tobacco they get through, right? It's a modern drug given, but nonetheless. An example that I've used is people in the Andes who chew coca, yeah? People who travel to the Andes usually separate their experience of chewing coca from if they've done cocaine, right? And yet the alkaloids are identical. And if you look at what people... Well, again, is that true? When people chew coca, they chew it with lime or some sort of other compound that effectively releases the free base, and it's in the buccal cavity, which gives direct, it misses first pass metabolism. So this is what I'm saying. When you really get into the particulars, right, and you look at how much coca your indigenous chewer gets through, they're getting through more cocaine than fairly enthusiastic urban users. So anyway, the point I'm trying to make is I'm unsure about the novelty argument.
Okay, thank you for that. That was really clarifying. We've got a question from outside. So let's have that, Gillian, if you could say who and what, and then we'll have a couple more questions from inside.
It's a question from Suzanne in London. It's more related to the sugar... In speech, and it's a question: was not the use of fructose encouraged by the U.S. government as a way of supporting American agriculture?
Wait, the microphone is coming to Laura to answer. Can we have the microphone, please?
The answer
is yes. Now, emphatically. An emphatic yes. Actually, a double yes. Both. The people talk about the corn subsidy, but actually, that promoted high fructose corn syrup, but only 17% of our corn subsidy goes to high fructose corn syrup. Most of it goes to ethanol. It's actually the sugar program, which is an old boys network, the cane and beet sugar producers that are the ones who really have a lockdown on Congress.
Okay, we're almost
out. There are European equivalents with the wine lake and so forth.
Okay, thank you. We're almost out of time for coffee break. I'm going to take two, please, very quick points and hopefully very quick responses. We've got Case over here, and then we've got France over there. Very short, please.
Thanks, Peter. If we are hardwired, isn't the simple answer not to focus on use, but on heavy use?
Thank
and
you.
Isn't it there that we have to build up walls to protect us?
Yep. That's a good comment. France?
Well, it's going a bit in the same direction, but let's say we have debated, of course, in the whole Alice Rap thing, the usefulness of the addiction concept, and I leave it for here because there have been very good remarks about problem use, etc., and all over time. I also got the feeling it's not so much about the concept, if I look in Laura's presentation. In fact, you want to use the concept, if I understand you well, you want to have the concept of addiction fitting to the sugar issue, which is, of course, a problem. I mean, it's a health problem. But you want to have it to be able to develop sugar control and, in fact, a punitive approach to sugar. And while we are in the field of certain drugs, we are moving away from the punitive approach. It looks that you look for making this addiction concept fitting to sugar to allow for a punitive approach, which I find fascinating.
Okay, that's a good point to end. So I'd like to thank very much our three speakers who've come a long way to really stimulate thinking and debate, and thank you. That's Roger, that's Robert, and that's Laura. So thank you all very much.